Hello and a warm welcome to another episode of the Bespoke Show. On every episode, we bring to our viewers expert insights on various contemporary topics. On this episode, I caught up with two very accomplished startup mentors, Mr. Vishwas Mudgal and Mr. Shiva Ramamurthy, to discuss the ramifications of the COVID-19 on the startup community. First, an introduction about the panelists. Vishwas is a celebrity entrepreneur, best-selling author, and an angel investor. His most prominent accomplishments are massive success of two companies, the Good Works co-working space and the Good Works Labs. Shiva is a corporate CEO and a global startup mentor. He holds an MBA from the Kellogg's School of Management, Northwestern University, USA, and an MS in Computer Science from the University of Kentucky. Welcome to both Vishwas and Shiva. I started off by asking them what, in their opinion, would be the impact on startups if we were to segment them as, say, early stage startups vis-a-vis the VC-funded mature startups, A. And B, would there be a win-lose matrix that we can arrive at for the future based on the current situation? And as a consequence, how they see e-commerce evolving in the coming months. And this is what they had to say.
See, essentially, right? I mean, if you're talking about a very early stage startup where you really aren't, don't have a particular product or a solution, you know, you still have 2020 to basically think through and build a great product, hoping for a demand in 2021 and 2022. And it really doesn't vastly change, because if it's a very early stage startup without any high quality customers or very clear customer traction, my opinion is it doesn't really change a whole lot for you, because you're still building something in the future. So what you really need to do is look at the outlook of what it will be in 2021 and most likely 2022. And in many cases, like one of the best indicators for you to look at is the stock market, or like especially the US markets, because they give a clear indication of what the belief is in the future. So that is as far as the early stage startup is concerned. What you can do is you can focus on creating very high quality product, understand the customer requirements extremely well, and build something that is fantastic. You have anyway taken the risk of leaving a job, so you know nothing changes as far as the early stage startup is concerned. In my opinion, I think the problem will be a lot more if it is a more mature startup with existing customers and even some traction with investors, because there'll be a lot of renegotiations in those cases. There are a lot of clauses in any contracts that are essentially, they make the landscape change quite drastically if there are some external situations like this, for sure. And this is one of the biggest situations that we have seen. So one thing you need to be really good at is your negotiation skills. Show extraordinary levels of empathy with both your customers, your partners, your investors, and everybody around, and negotiate, showcase the promise, take some personal sacrifices wherever possible, but don't go overboard with it, because that's not what you're there for, and try and survive. I think the problem will be a little bit more challenging from a more mature startup compared to very early stage.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. I think the more mature startups, I like what you said about the word empathy, because I think both sides are under a lot of pressure. The customers are also under pressure in terms of pricing, in terms of cash flow, while the startups are under pressure in terms of their own stakeholders' expectations. So I think empathy is the right approach in this situation.
Yeah.
And if we were to segment the sectors that are going to be most hit, or the ones that are going to be benefited, in my opinion, what I feel is the edutech space, the fintech space, and the gaming space, they all seem to be thriving under the current situation.
Right.
Whereas if you look at the hospitality or the tourism or the aviation space, they are the ones that are the worst hit. And
right.
It could take a long time for them to revive the setback and regain their lost positions. What
That's
is your
right.
take on this, Shiva?
See, I think there is, there are two aspects to it. One is, what is the view currently, and what is it likely to happen a year from now or 2 years from now? Right? In most cases, remember, you're building a startup for 2 years from now, not really for today. Today is useful, but it's not really the most important thing. And if you look at some of the sectors that are done very well in the last 1.5 months, the ones you rightfully identified, to a large extent, technology sector, remote working solutions like Zoom, Stock is on fire, if you look at it. And that's great. But having said that, anyone who's used any virtual solution right now, including the one we are in, will definitely agree that we are definitely not in the ultimate solution of it. It leaves a lot to be desired. You know, for example, why isn't there a ticker out there telling me what my internet speed is right now?
Right.
I have a small ticker on my left-hand side of my cell phone telling me what my internet speed is. Why isn't it bundled? Why isn't it telling me that my internet connection is unstable? Why is it so, the user-friendliness could definitely improve. I'm stuck across the board in all platforms. And the capacity to record, I mean, there's so many bells and whistles, it confuses everyone, right? So there's definitely a lot more opportunities for improvement in existing solutions, especially remote working, and especially with the launch of 5G services, etc. I think the next 10 years we'll see a lot of growth in that particular segment for sure. But in terms of areas like transportation, airline, etc., see, the fact that they've been hit is already news. It's already baked in. People know that, right? Now they're talking about what next. They're talking not about 2020, but 2021 and probably 2022. And you know, it could actually be a good time to go back to the drawing board and rethink a lot of travel solutions. Of course, number one, figure out why are we traveling so much. You know, increase the number of conferencing solutions, virtual meetings at a large scale. There's nothing that says you can't have thousands of people in a virtual meeting, and maybe you could do 3 meetings at the same time, which is phenomenal, right? I mean, a busy professional can do like 20 times more by being in 10 conferences at the same time and just cherry picking what he or she needs to do.
Right.
For example, you know, the one of the conversations I was listening to a few days back was the CEO, about a week back, was the CEO of Delta, who talked about how they are actually boarding from the back. So even if you're a business class or a first class, I mean, assuming you are, you don't go in the beginning. You wait till everybody boards, it's back to front, and people in the front come last. And likewise, when you move, you when you get down on the plane, you probably go first and last. So there's minimal touch points, and there is a lot of things that they will come through. It's very hard to see the light at the end of the tunnel during a time frame like this, but it's hard. It's a mixed bag to it, right? See, overall, my feeling is, while sectors may have a temporary up and down, but that's not necessarily the baseline of it.
Okay.
The baseline of it is what is the economic dynamics of it, right? And if the economic dynamics is that the human population is still increasing and people have to travel, people have to strike deals, and that is going to happen. It's going to be 2022, maybe not 2021. Definitely not 2020, we all agree on that. But it's still the same baseline, and you as a startup are building solutions for a little bit into the future, right?
Interesting. Thank you, Shiva, for those very articulate insights. I'll come back to you again. Vishwas, if I may come to you now, what is your take on the impact of COVID-19 on the various sectors, especially with reference to the e-commerce space?
So I believe that e-commerce is going to really boom at this point in time, because people are going to avoid going to the malls and all the shops out there, and they somehow feel that if the e-commerce guys figure out a right way of doing the contactless experience, contactless delivery, then I think things are going to work really well. So if you look at a lot of the e-commerce guys right now, what they're trying to do is that, of course, right now it is only about essentials. They're trying to figure out how do they give the temperatures for the people, right? For the last few days, whether it's the chefs or people who are delivering it. Also, they are encouraging people to pay online so that you don't have to actually go and exchange money at the end point where you're handing over the stuff. Number three is that they're not even ringing the bell. So just keeping it outside in a place where you want it, and then they're going back. So there is a lot of these innovations that are happening. And I think going forward, there are going to be like PPE kits and stuff like that, where you're going to be like protecting yourselves. These personnel are going to have that in whatever format they're going to have. So I think that's going to be some kind of innovation in e-commerce. So because of which, I think people are going to be much more, comfortable in ordering, at least for the next 6 months. And that's going to kind of set a trend for the e-commerce companies where things could become irreversible, right? So, for example, during the demonetizations, like people really got used to the Paytm and transferring money through their mobile phones or whatever the digital, the transfer happened, right? So that changed the behavior of the consumer altogether. So now the same thing is happening for, it could happen for many industries, especially for e-commerce. And number two is because there's so many people in Practo, for example, and there it's going to be a huge opportunity for them, right? So what they're trying to do at this point in time is that they are bringing online consultations. So whether it is a chat-based consultation or online video consultation or whatever, so that is going to be a game changer for them. And if they are able to really bring a great experience of having consultations online, even when after 6 months, even when things get back to normal, the vaccine comes and miraculously all these things just goes away, assuming, even then people are just going to continue doing things online because that's what it is going to do. And another interesting trend is a lot of these sectors right now where there are like heavy machinery equipments, or wherever you need people to actually go physically see stuff and then purchase it, or you come and do a training for them, all of that. So all of that is going to be very difficult going forward. So how are people trying to change it is by using technologies like AR and VR, for example. So to showcase 3D models of equipment, or without even going somewhere, you can choose and customize like a color of the wall, or what kind of a stuff it goes into, what kind of sofa goes where, things like that, right? So technology intervention is going to be very key. So these are sectors that are going to thrive. Now coming back to your question of which of the sectors are really badly hit. So if you look at travel, tourism and hospitality, those guys, I think before 2022, I think that it's going to be the last one to revive, and real estate as well. And unfortunately, I run a company in co-working, and I believe it's going to have its own, it's going to be like challenging times for all of us in the real estate industry. And demand is going to come down. People are going to cut costs because they don't want to work from office anymore. And that's where the issues are going to come in real estate. And people are not going to go and out and buy apartments or some fancy stuff at this point in time, because they are thinking about, I need to survive at this point in time. I want to conserve cash because I don't know whether my job is going to be there next month or not. So I'm not going to be spending anything. So real estate is the last thing that I'm going to do. So that's going to totally tank at this point in time. And of course, even automobiles are going to take its own sweet time to come back. And then financial services is another problem area. Of course, retail and apparel, because we work with really large retail companies. And I was thinking that, because these people have really FMCG giants and they are not going to get affected. And I was very surprised with the kind of the move they made, because I think they're so scared because they just want to conserve all the cash. They've cut a lot of their expenses. They have taken extreme decisions to cut down their costs. So I feel that those people are not spared as well. So that's where the problem is at this point in time. And people are not going to buy clothes. People who are like, all the Gucci's and Louis Vuitton's of the world, they're going to have a tough time for the next year or so. It's going to be very difficult for them to sell anything. And only people who are going to make, I think, things are going to run is healthcare, media, entertainment. You saw Netflix announced today, they have added another 15 million people in the last quarter. across the globe. So you can see the kind of consumption that's going to go. Whatever is there online is going to thrive. That's going to happen. And technology is going to bounce back for sure, because I can see that happening at this point in time itself. Up until like a couple of weeks back, people were panicking. They didn't know what to do. But slowly now we're getting a lot of inquiries for building technologies that are enabling people to service their customers online, and security related stuff. People are figuring out how to stay afloat, how do they create some pivots in terms of technology and innovation and business models, creating their MVP they can launch in the next 2-3 months, raising seed investment in that area or pitching to customers in that area. So that's where the economy is going to go forward. And of course, education is one area I feel that it's going to bounce back fairly quickly. And things are going online there as well. And agriculture is, of course, I think it's still going to go, because governments can never stop agriculture. So I think these are all okay. But it's definitely going to take about 6 to 9 months for the entire economy to even start figuring out what to do next.
That was a very comprehensive coverage. How do you see this Ola's and the Uber's shaping up? Because of the social distancing, I think many people would feel skeptical about using those. And also, I was thinking about the offline entertainment houses. I think people would think twice before getting into social gatherings. So do you see them just fading away, or they're going to bounce back?
Yeah, so for example, Ola and I think Uber sent me a message yesterday saying that, okay, they are now dropping people to the hospitals, so they have started operating right now. So they're going to be essential, but their traffic or their business is going to drastically come down. That's for sure. But they're going to be operating. I think they're going to have protective gear inside their vehicles. They're going to figure out how do they cut the transmission between the driver and the people sitting in the back. So I think they're going to do some innovation to protect themselves or wear some PPE kits. So there is going to be some kind of a contactless, the experience that they need to work on. But I think that they're going to come back. But I feel that next two, three quarters are going to be very difficult for them as well.
I think there's going to be the same problem also in the airlines, because they are talking of leaving the middle seat open, but the representation that's coming across is that that's not going to solve the problem, because 2 feet distance is not going to solve the problem. Rather, it's the damage is more in terms of loss of revenue rather than the potential contagion that is going to cause.
Yeah, and also you have the AC, right? So it recirculates the air, so it's not going to help. So that's a problem.
Delta
Airlines the CEO in an interview yesterday talked about for example, right now in the US flights are going on, right? It's not in a complete shutdown, and of course it's like 5% of the capacity. It's not like the real stuff. Airlines, for example, in the US are boarding from the back. So even if you have first class or business class in the front, you don't board immediately, like you board in the last. So it's basically, so that people don't have to cross each other anymore. And another thing is, if you look at how the workforce, like let's just go fast forward into say December 2020 or like even 2021, and when the workforces come back, people start going to Vishwash's co-working spaces and other places, hopefully sooner. And the question there'll be constant ways to monitor the temperature and so forth. One of the startups that I'm actually advising is they actually make video recognition software, so that is used in attendance tracking of universities, etc. So students, when they walk into the engineering class, they don't need to say yes sir, no sir, whatever, yes ma'am, no ma'am. It just takes it automatically. And now they're adding on a temperature sensitivity, because these are two different cameras, because they offer it in different spectrums. So basically, when you go into Vishwas's office or its co-working space, not only would you have I logged in, but my temperature today is 96.3. and so forth. So there'll be some innovations that will come in, you know, for sure. You know, one more thing is, if let's say 2022 comes in, 2 years go by, right? If someone sneezes in Ethiopia, Brazil will shut down in 2 hours, right? Because paranoia won't go away for another 10 years. And any health outbreak, like for example, if the Nipah virus were to happen in 2020, that's it. The entire thing will shut down. Like other countries will stop flying out of India for the next minute. So there'll be a lot of that reaction that will go into probably another 5-6 years. You know, I was doing a comparative study between what happened post World War II, because World War II is probably a very traumatic event compared to not in our lifetime, but before that. And even post winning, like the winners, like US and USSR, they become really paranoid for like 20, 30 years, right? Because the experience which they've seen lasted for some time. In our time, we have a lot more distractions. We have social media, so we'll forget things quicker. But not like immediately. It'll take 4 years to do that. And startups and innovators who create solutions that address that immediate fear will actually be benefited. In terms of cars, there is actually one other alternate opinion that's going on, which is sales of individual cars. That's controversial. I don't know whether to agree with it or not. May actually increase. Not increase from like 2015 levels or like Prospera levels, but from extreme down to a little bit upwards, because people would want to be alone. Right? So that could also be another segment to look at. I think there'll be a lot of reject, you know, in terms of everything. I think if I was a startup, I would really spend a lot of time watching like CNBC, the US version, which shows up in the evening, because that's a much bigger scale economy and so forth. And the conversations really give you a good view of which segments will do well, which won't do well, and what is the outlook into 2021.
That's interesting. And Shiva, just to continue with you, since you have been in the pharma space, we've been seeing a lot of news about FDI from into China being controlled in the last 1 week or so. How do you see that impacting the Indian startups in the pharma space? Is that an opportunity, or are they going to be losers because of shortage of funding opportunities?
Well, that's a bit tricky. I mean, see, the specific context of the discussion was on HDFC's 1% acquisition. Right. You know, there is a lot of Chinese investors who have played a very active and good role in growing several Indian startups. I don't mean today, I mean over the last 2-3 years or even more. And China is also a very, very big innovation hub. I mean, if you look at artificial intelligence startups, I mean, they are really number one. So it's a multi-pronged, you know, complex decision. Coming to pharma specifically in healthcare, you know, if you look at the bulk of Indian opportunities, they come in the area of what's called as generics, right? So the patent for a medicine is for a total of 20 years. It takes 14 years for it to become a medicine to take through like 3 trials. People don't realize it. Like all the medicines that are approved today started in 2003. Okay. So you don't have a medicine today. It doesn't happen. It takes 14 years to become one. And most of the Indian, pharma make is leads in the world of generics, which is once the patent expires, the product mix is basically available to anyone. So you can't do the same process, but you could do it in a different process. I mean, just theoretically, right? If the molecule is H2O, I mean, you could get H2O by H2O plus burning it, or you could do it some other way. So long as you resynthesize it in a different way, it's fine. And Indian pharma is very, very big in this. And for example, the HCQ, which is the malarial drug, which has became very famous for 2 weeks ago. Mm-hmm. And that's like a drug which is long beyond its patent. It's probably 100 years old or something. So that's which Indian pharma leads in. Besides that, I mean, pharma is not really a startup kind of a thing. It's more a mature company kind of a thing. Right. There isn't really a startup pharma. Right. But if you, you know, in terms of, you know, the healthcare, right? I mean, as Vishwas talked about, I mean, online booking or anything that is going to enable you to see patients online, it's going to be great. And, you know, ironically enough, I had a conversation with a startup about 4 hours back, and the co-founders are doctors. And the same question was asked, like, what do we do for funding? One of the ideas I threw to them is, hey, you're doctors. As a doctor, you have an individual competence, which never goes away, so long as there are human beings and people have diseases, which sadly we are having more and more of it. You can practice, right?
Right.
You can continue to do your startup, but essentially have an alternate source of revenue, which is practicing. And another very interesting thing is the world of healthcare practice is global. For example, there's a Canadian startup who I've been closely advised with, and they actually cater to Indian patients. Like, trust me, there are a lot of situations where we want a second opinion. It doesn't need to be cancer. It could even be something smaller than that. And a lot of people can afford like a $50 consultation. In 2020, they could. And that's a big opportunity for them. I mean, and there's a Canadian startup which does that. It doesn't target for India per se. It's for like global. But at least 50% or 60% of her customers are Indian customers. So it's a lot of opportunities on that.
Yeah, I'm not sure how much legal it is for tele-consulting and video consulting when it comes to healthcare in India, right?
Absolutely, it's a very gray area.
Right.
And there's a lot of vagueness in that.
Right. But still, it's good to know that there are ample opportunities for people to explore even under the current situation.
Yeah, and another thing is radiology, for example. People don't understand, know this. I think the one career which is likely to be similar to what happened to a travel agent is radiologist, because a typical mammogram in 2020 does take some time to decipher. And mammogram is not like a black and white. It's not like a blood work where there'll be a particular coloration and you will know what the number of your cholesterol is, etc. So it's kind of a beauty contest or an unbeauty contest, to use the other word. It depends on the radiologist's skill to be able to figure it out. So artificial intelligence, for example, is massive in 2019, forget 2020, in figuring out cancer. And what they're doing is they're feeding, like, you know, many startups are feeding like thousands and thousands of mammograms, both healthy as well as the ones which have cancer, and that's basically neural networks, right? I mean, the neural networks like CNN neural networks and so forth, and they're making the machine learn. So by the end of 2020, it's already happened in many parts of the world. Radiology, there'll be a lot of AI in radiology.
Right. Vishwas, I've been reading in the news of late that a lot of Japanese companies and Korean companies are planning to shift base into India. Do you see that opening up a lot of opportunities for the startup sector in India, and maybe not in terms of the original equipments themselves, but more in terms of the auxiliaries and support services that can be explored for the Indian startups?
I think so. And I think it is a golden opportunity for India to basically tell the world that, you know, listen, that we are ready to take this leadership on the global front, and we are here to address your concerns. And we have a huge skill labor at this point in time. And we have the right kind of a government support, supply chain, and all of that. So the kind of stuff that China did to, you know, bring their economy to the next level. So I think that same opportunity has been presented to us again. I think that is one advantage that has come out of this disadvantage at this point in time. But a lot of it is going to really matter how the government is going to be proactive and handle that. Because of course, as a startup, it's so much. Of course, you can do it on your individual capacity. You can do your innovation. You can do things from the manufacturing perspective or innovation in artificial intelligence, whatever that you can do. But if it has to go to the grassroots level and become a kind of a hit of mass scale, right? So where it goes to like a tipping point and it becomes like a it creates a good critical mass for us in the whole manufacturing base. I think government needs to step in, and it needs to like say, okay, these are the 10 things that India is going to do at this point in time. This is how we're going to train our vocational guys. This is how the people are going to be trained to like, you know, for the factory workers so that they can work on equipment, precision, and they're going to have a supply chain in certain fashion like this. This is how the kind of incentives people are going to get when they come to India and set up their base and stuff like that, right? So that's could, that could become like a game changer for us, because sentiment against China is terrible at this point in time, right? So people are like, never ever before, I think, of course, we have now not seen things when it happened in World War II. I'm sure people hated Germans and Nazis and stuff like that. But of course, now the kind of a hatred that people have for Chinese, it's at an individual basis. It's at the grassroots level. People are hating them so much. Whatever it is, I think, of course, China could have done it so much in a much better way, but they have totally screwed it up. And the price is, you know, everybody is paying that price. So I think that India should capitalize on that right now. And then we should put us back on the map and utilize it.
Yeah, so I guess this is the best opportunity for us to make the vision of making India a reality.
Absolutely. I think this is the perfect opportunity. But I don't see the kind of will in the government. I don't know how they're going to do, because I strongly feel that the government lacks the economic think tank. I don't know. So I feel that it's kind of missing. I think more and more people are being more vocal about it right now. Of course, there's a lot of support for Modi and all of that. But the problem I feel is that there is no economic, powerhouse there. That is the issue right now. Like, demonetization.
Right.
Like it wiped out, so many industries, wiped out so many jobs, wiped out, our growth. Nothing came out of it, for example, right? So the government is able to take, very, very hard decisions, but, they're not thinking through it, right way. So that is the issue. But I hope that, they're able to do something about this situation right now. And making India could be a great thing.
Yeah. And also, I think a lot of improvement or focus is required in the infrastructure space to be able to cope with that kind of demand from an industry perspective.
Correct. That is a major issue.
Yeah. Shiva, you have any thoughts to share on that point?
I think it's been very well captured by the both of you. The thing is, what happens between now and what happens between 2021 and 2022, right? I mean, is very complex, right? I mean, the one earlier version that I saw in a lot of global think tanks is that all countries would want to build a certain level of insourcing in the country, like, supply chains, like, it wouldn't be so global where they're dependent on everything from every other, from other country. At least in like core strategic issues like medicines and etc. Right? For example, like there was a lot of thought in the US business press, because US is such a large power, and they having to wait for other countries for medicines, etc., was very, very unusual for them, because that is because of the nature of the supply chain where countries depend on each other. So there will be some focus towards building some strategic reserve, for example, in the US or any country, you have this thing called strategic oil reserve, where they all plan and they take a particular, they save a lot of oil there in case of, countries don't supply them oil and so forth. So it's hard to say whether, how it will all look like in 2021 or 2022, because these are not so much 2020 issues. These are probably 2021, 2022 issues.
Right.
It's very, there are a lot of global macro issues at stage that have to come through.
Vishwas, before I go to a concluding question, I have one question for you from an investor's perspective. Would you actually make use of this opportunity to invest in new startups? I'm talking of 2020. On terms favorable to you from an investor's perspective, or would you take a wait and watch approach and try to consolidate what you have already invested and then take the next step forward?
See, the immediate reaction for me has been that, you know, we need to be more prudent. Especially I'm like an angel investor, so you know, we invest in very few. Like in a year I invest in like 2 to 3 startups, between like 20 lakhs to about 1 crore. That is the range that I invest in, and usually these are like pre-series A kind of startups, and I invest through some of the
angel
investment the platforms that are there out there, which are quite helpful. But right now, I've taken like a wait and watch approach. That's because I want to be a little bit more prudent on my perspective. But of course, that is my personal investment thesis at this point in time, because I don't want to play around with a lot of uncertainties. I just want to like sit back and see, okay, how things are going to go in the next 1 or 2 quarters. And then, okay, then we will see. But having said that, if I see something that's awesome and it's going to like really, I feel that that's going to be like a game changer in the months to come, in the years to come, I think I will definitely go ahead and invest in it. But I think, you know, how the valuation is already low at this point in time. So I believe that if you get the right startup which you want to invest in, you have the right the model and you have the right entrepreneurs, you could get benefited right now if you invest and get a good valuation at this point in time. But yeah, that having said that, I believe that it's better to just wait and watch. That's what I am doing at this point.
Right. So is it an opportunity then for inorganic acquisitions?
Oh, yeah.
Because the valuations are abysmally low, I would think.
Yeah. So a couple of things have happened, right? So many companies have now approached us that they want to acquire us. Okay, so that suddenly happened in the last few weeks. Some of them for the technology division, some of them for the co-working company that we have. So, but of course, you know, we are not in that stage where we want to sell at this point in time. So we are ignoring it. On the other hand, I can see that, especially for the co-working spaces right now, many of them, they don't have the cash, right? So they don't know what to do, because first of all, the customers are not paying them. And these people have to pay to the landlord. So they are like stuck in between. And it's a very thin margin business. So now they don't know what to do. So many of them have approached me to say that, you know, whether can we take over those companies? Is it possible to like take over the leases, you know, in different formats? You know, that's the kind of the market sentiment that is there right now. So I think there's going to be a lot of small companies shutting down. If you look at in China, the estimate is last few months, about 3 to 4 lakh companies have shut down. So that is the estimate. Now, you know, we are not hit that stage yet in India, and I'm hoping it's not that bad, but a lot of companies are going to shut down. And today, if you look at today's Economic Times, entire paper is filled with this news that, you know, there are going to be a lot of layoffs in the startup sector. A lot of companies are going to face a lot of challenges. So I believe that it's going to be a tough year. The worst things are, we're not even hit that right now. And I think, you know, there's going to be cash flow issues. People will not have cash reserves. It's going to be a little problematic. So I believe that if you have the right kind of cash, you want to buy some companies, it could be a good opportunity right now.
Yeah, I think if a lot of the companies hold back their plans on IPOs and further investments, I think it's going to be a huge setback to the economy at a macro level as well, isn't it?
Yes, that's going to happen right now, because I believe the IPOs will get pushed. Most of the people don't know how they will react to it. Companies like Oyo, right now their revenues are tanked completely. You know, companies like Ola, they don't know what to do next. So it's gonna take some time for people to go hit IPOs.
Right. So maybe on a concluding note, I would like to hear from both of you. What are the 2 or 3 things that the startup ecosystem should be doing to make sure that many of the high potential startups don't fade away in the next 3 to 6 months. They at least stay afloat so that when things get better early 2021, they can bounce back into the economy. Maybe Vishwas?
Yeah. So what I believe is, I think that number one, they need to survive. That's what my number one suggestion and advice has been, that you need to be still standing. So that is the number one thing. So you got to figure out a way to conserve your cash. You got to figure out a way to reduce your expenses in the, cash burn. That's very critical. And number two is, you need to figure out a way to hold on to your key customers, key partners, even though there is less margin, renegotiate, but make sure that you're still alive. Basically, that's number one thing that you got to do. So that, when things are going to be back, they're going to be back with vengeance, you're going to, have that opportunity to come back that time, right? And number two is, I believe that use technology as a way to deliver to your customers. I think that is going to be key going forward, because everything is going to come online. And if as much as possible, I think we need to look at introducing technology, automations, artificial intelligence. I think that is going to be the game changer. So going forward, I think that, this could even, push us towards the, the onslaught of the, robotics maybe, right? So bring in robots earlier, right? So than what we really thought about earlier. So that's kind of a situation we are going to be in. So I think these two things are really critical. And I think the third thing, what I feel is that, focus on your marketing as well right now. So communicating to your customers, saying that, listen, that, we are here for you. We understand your pain point. We are there to support you. And then that, telling them that, we are here to support, for example, for co-working right now, what are we trying to do? So we are having a series of webinars, like the same thing what we're doing here right now. So we are having a series of webinars for all the people in the customers that we're having. We gave them out, for example, free credits of AWS, where we partnered with Amazon for that, like $200 free credit for Amazon for all the companies that are there. So we're trying to figure out a way to engage and then benefit these people who are not able to come and use your services. So that kind of a communication, that kind of a marketing also is going to be key, that that you still are able to be relevant in the coming times.
Interesting. Shiva, are you there?
Yeah.
You're back. So what would be your three most important advices for startups to stay afloat while we navigate through this phase?
Yeah. See, one is, communicate and vastly increase the operational communication, which is there at every level with various stakeholders, your employees, partners, customers, your founders, in case you have, and keep doing that, because, at this stage, right, irrespective of whether, you are a 25-year-old or a 70-year-old, you kind of need to be the mom and dad of the entire company to basically thrive in that situation. And second is, relook the problem you're solving. You started the startup with a fundamental idea of solving a problem faster, cheaper, and better than anyone else out there. Is it still valid? Can you still do it? What has changed? And what is the plus? What is the minus? And make sure you have a unique value proposition that sustains into 2021, into so forth. That's point number two. Point number three is, the basis of business is output is greater than input, right? As in, while the startup ecosystem and the Silicon Valley kind of make a mentality of, taking a lot of losses and then going up late, right? But the coronavirus, there is need for the output to be very close to the input, and hence figure out what revenue sources can you create in the immediate, so that you don't have too much of a negative to catch up. If it means that you're going to slow down in the product development cycle, that may perhaps be okay too. I mean, the traditional California Silicon Valley mindset is, you know, I think one of the Bangalore entrepreneurs talked about it as in a very, very basic word, it's like qualavery e-commerce, which basically means, e-commerce at any cost kind of a thing, right? If you look at the traditional California mindset, which is like, you take one problem, get all the revenues, you throw everything you have at it, and it either goes up or it just destroys itself, right? I think you may not want, you know, you may consider thinking whether that's the model you want or whether it'll be a little bit more slower, where you focus on what you generate, which is revenue, and try to make it close to the input and try to push it down into 21 for better days. That could be another strategy you could consider as well.
So prioritizing.
Yeah.
Splendid insights. If I were to represent a startup community, I think what I would tell myself under this situation is don't let the situation drag you down. Stay upbeat because opportunities will come by. Because earlier when there was the 2008 recession, many people said that things are not going to come back for the next few years, but it only took a couple of years for things to bounce back and people started going places again. So I guess we will be in a similar situation going forward. So the messages for the startups, just to consolidate from what you have said, I would say is going back to your drawing board to revisit the value proposition, one. Two, relook at your marketing skills and make sure that your customer relationships are nurtured to the maximum potential. And three, make good use of technology to survive through this phase. Thank you so much to both Vishwas and Shiva for sparing your valuable time.